Om sahana bhavatu sahana bhunaktu sahaviryam karavavahai tejasvinavahai tamastu mavidvishavahai Om shanti 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 Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Guru Deva Maheshwara Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Samaskatana Kalyani Nuratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadguru Brahma Vidvaram Om Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Kathitam Puranam Mahabharatam Advaitamrita Varshinim Bhagavatim Ashtadashadhyayinim Ambatva Manusandadhami Bhagavad Gita Bhavadveshinim Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Maruta Sunmante Devyaisavai Vedai Sangapadakramo Panishadai Vayanti Yamsamaga Dhyana Vasthita Tadgatena Manasa Pashyanti Yam Yogina Yasyantam Navidusura Suragana Devaya Tasmai Namaha Devaya Tasmai So, chapter number 13. First six chapters, Karma Yoga, next six chapters, Bhakti Yoga, last six chapters, Vyayam Yoga. So, the last six chapters, they begin with this chapter number 13. So, this is called Kshetra, Kshetra Me Vibhav Yoga. The distinction between the field and the knower of the field. That's the technical name of this chapter. So, in this 13th chapter, there is discrimination which is being done. Because knowledge will arise when there is clarity. Clarity arises when there is discrimination. Vivek. And this chapter is also to establish the oneness of the individual with the Supreme. So if we go by a traditional classification, the first six chapters deal with the individual, plum. How the individual can work hard, do karma yoga, purify the mind and know the self. The next six chapters deal with tat, who is the Lord, how is he a source of creation? How does he create? And then the last six chapters are Asi, to establish the oneness of the individual and the Supreme. So this chapter, through the process of discrimination, tries to establish that sense of oneness. And so let us see. Self-knowledge or Brahma Vidya in its purest form is most strongly presented in this particular chapter. Very beautiful verses on the self you will find in this. One can contemplate on those verses. So those who are Jnana Margis, following the path of intellect, they can discriminate between the real and the unreal and contemplate on the real and experience the Supreme Truth as one's own true self. So, body, mind, intellect, ego, these are not me, these are my equipment. That is clearly explained in this particular chapter. Each chapter has its own significance, no doubt in that. Because this is Gyan Marg, the Gyan Marg starts with using more the power of buddhi, intellect. Bhakti Marg takes up emotion, surrender through that coming of the truth. Karma Marg takes up action, work for a higher ideal. Jnana Marg takes up intellectual discrimination. And then living up to that conviction that this is only an equipment, my true nature is Sachidananda. That understanding when one has, then one is following the Jnana Marg. And so we find here that one of the meanings of the word asi, asi also means a sword. So a sword which divides, which destroys the difference between the jiva and supreme. That ignorance which makes us feel I am separate, world is separate, God is separate. That knowledge which destroys this duality, this difference. So asi indicates that. And so we find here that last chapter, 12th chapter, Bhagavan spoke about form and the formless, and how when Arjuna asked which is better, he didn't say which one is better. He said wherever your mind abides, what you can do consistently, with faith, that is the path that is best suited for you. And he also explained in that how contemplation on the formless is very difficult for somebody who is attached to the body. Only one shloka was given there about the formless. In this chapter you will find more verses about the formless. So somebody who is following the path of Jnana Marg will use the pointers of the self to know the truth. So this chapter begins. So there are two versions of the Gita actually. One version of the Gita has 700 verses. Because 13th chapter begins with Bhagavan straight away starting the chapter. Another version of Gita says there are 701 verses. Because there is a question in this 13th chapter, in reply to which Bhagavan is giving this whole answer. So we are going by that version for better understanding that what is the question of Arjuna. So Arjuna has asked this question about three things in this 13th chapter. I don't know if you have that question with you in your book. If it is there, very good. If it is not there, just follow. Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Atha Trayodasho Dhyayaha. Arjuna Uvacha.
Arjuna Uvacha.
Prakritim Purusham Chaiva.
Prakritim Purusham Chaiva.
Kshetram Kshetrajnyam Eva Cha.
Kshetram Kshetrajnyam Eva Cha.
Etat Veditum Icchami.
Etat Veditum Icchami.
Jnanam Jneyam Cha Keshava. So Bhagavan had said in the last chapter, last verse, Iti Guhyatamam Shastram. This is a very sacred and a secret knowledge. Iti Guhyatamam Shastram, Ida Mukta Mayanaka, Eta Guhya Buddhiman Shastram. No, 12th chapter, last verse. This was 15th chapter, last verse. 12th chapter, last verse is, Yetu Dharmyamritam Idam Yathoktam Parivapasate. This immortal dharma, whoever follows in this particular way, that person is dearest to me. Whatever he said in that 12th chapter. The nature of that Lord, the knowledge about that Lord, gaining which that person becomes immortal, that is revealed in this 13th chapter. Now, in this 13th chapter, that's why question of Arjuna is asking three things. So first he says, Prakritim Purusham Chaiva. I want to know the difference between these three things. What are these three things? Etat Veditum Icchami. First I want to know the difference between Prakriti and Purusham. Very important difference. Because in the world, if you see today, when the people say, I don't believe in God, but I believe in nature. That is believing in Prakriti. But how does Prakriti function? There is an enduring principle that is called as Purusha. In absence of that Purusha, Prakriti cannot function. And in absence of Prakriti, Purusha cannot manifest. So there is a connection between Prakriti and Purusha, and that has to be understood properly. So he says, I want to know what is this Prakriti and Purusha. Then he says, Kshetra and Kshetrajna, the field and the knower of the field. This is a little technical terminology. So field does not mean here the loving field. Field here is the field of experience. And who is the knower of this? Our body, mind, intellect, they are functioning. How are they functioning? Who is the knower of this? Is it different? That discrimination between the life principle, which is the knower, and the expressions of that through equipment. So this is that I want to know. Difference between the knower of the field and the field. And then third one he says, I want to know what is knowledge, jnanam and jnanam. What is that which is the goal of life, to be known? Knowing which nothing remains to be known. So this chapter deals with these three aspects. But before we go into these three aspects, a little background introduction about discrimination is very necessary. So going by the understanding of the Jnana Marga, we realize that the more I think of myself as a limited entity, the more there will be sorrow. The more I identify with this small I, ego, more is the sorrow. And we don't know, not only that I identify with small I, the fact also that I don't know who am I. By doing these three types of discrimination, it may sound very technical, but the idea is to know who am I and what I am not. The most fundamental question in life is, who am I? And to know that, this clarity must be there. What is the knower, what is the known? We have mixed up these two things, knower and the known. Prakriti and Purusha, knowledge and the goal of life, all mix up. This is one who can discriminate this, that person will get the clarity and live a life of fulfillment. So here he sees that there is an urgent need for this knowledge. It is not just an intellectual knowledge or just some inquiry which somebody is doing because they don't have anything else to do. Why is this knowledge required? Because I don't know who I am. So if I mix up myself, for just an example, if I feel that I am this phone, whatever happens to this phone now happens to me. But actually it is not so. Whatever happens to phone doesn't happen to me because I am completely separate. In this example it is easy to understand because this very two distinct entities. But in other example it is not easy. Where the ego and consciousness is mixed up, that is not easy. Or where milk and water is mixed up, not easy to discriminate. There are similar things. And hence it is that a person who has thought about life, has understood that no matter what I do in life, till I don't know who I am, that sense of emptiness will not go. It will only be replaced with a temporary sense of achievement. And I feel good about it. And it may also happen that going by these achievements in life, my intellect may become dull and gross, that it doesn't feel that there is a need to do any type of higher discrimination. I have achieved whatever I wanted to achieve. It is also possible to fall into that state of intellectual tamas, lack of inquiry. Because then I have whatever I wanted, I am achieving. And I have some clarity that this is what I want to achieve in my life, beyond job, beyond work, beyond family. I may serve the society, be good, do good, that's all. So further inquiry is not happening. And that's why in the Jnana Marga, the most important factor is to awaken this buddhi. And buddhi can be awakened only when discrimination is awakened. That there are two things, and then these two things need to be separated and not separating these two is the cause of my sorrow. That there is a self, which is my true nature as happiness, and that there is an ego, which is separate, and that ego is the cause of my sorrow, is not understood. Ego is considered to be real, permanent. This is what I am, full stop. What else apart from this is there? That is not known. And so the masters, they always say, the Upanishad, they say, uttishtata jagrata, arise and awake. What has to be awakened? Vivek has to be awakened. That there are two things in life, there is temporary and permanent. So this buddhi, when it gets awakened, then a person can identify with the self and come to know the higher reality. Even if one doesn't know the self, at least one should know that if there is everything which is temporary around me, there is something permanent which is sustaining that. Because I see only change everywhere and temporary things everywhere. That there is a permanent reality is not even known. How to even seek that? Hence the buddhi has to be awakened, discrimination has to be awakened. And so this power of discrimination is the power of intellect, which is there only in the human being. Everybody else does. It's not that nobody discriminates. People do discriminate, not people, sorry. Other creatures do discriminate. So animal also will discriminate what to eat and what not to eat, where to go, where not to go. It knows. It may do it by instinct, that is a different matter. It may not do it intelligently. Sometimes it does intelligently also. Most of the time it is instinct driven. So it knows who is a friend, who is an enemy, what to eat, what not to eat, where am I safe, where I am not safe. I belong to this herd, I don't belong to that. In the same species, they will have their own groups. So all that discrimination is done. That is called sthul vivek or gross discrimination. Human being also is capable of doing that. But majority of the human beings will live with that much. Maximum they will do little more right and wrong. But there is a subtler form of discrimination that is called sukshma viveka. That needs to be awakened to know my own true self. And that sukshma viveka is what this chapter is trying to awaken in us. And hence, the very word viveka means to separate. So if two things which are different have got mixed up together, it's very easy to separate. So the example given, let us say, so rice and stone, easy to separate. But if two similar things are mixed up, very difficult. Milk and water, chili powder and brick powder, sweet and blotting paper. I don't know whether it happens here, but in South India it happens. There is one dish, sweet dish called basundi. If you eat that, and if that quality is not good, some fellow has done adulteration there, you will get literally red blotting paper. You put on. So, those things are difficult to discriminate because they are similar things. That's why the symbol of Vivek is a swan. Which discriminates milk from water. I don't know if really swan can discriminate that way. And sometimes people say it's a mythological bird, but there is a swan. It's not a mythological bird, swan. There is bird. Swan exists as a species. So one of the curiosity I have is like to find out, get one swan and tell it to me. Can it drink milk and water? Means it drinks away all the milk and it leaves the water. How strange. So anyway, that is the difficulty when two similar things are mixed up. But when there are no two things, when it is not known that there are two things, then how to do? I don't even know that there is a consciousness which envelops the body. Then very difficult to separate. I think body functions on its own. Or there is some power which is making it function. But I don't know what is that power. Then to discriminate is very, very tough. So how will I even know that there are two? That's why the study of scripture, or go to somebody who has understood this, done this vivek, has some clarity, why this, there are two, why there is not only one. And that vivek needs to get awakened. Hence there are these two types of vivek. One is the subtler vivek, and the other is the grosser vivek. So the subtler vivek has a greater impact on our life, and it has greater sorrows. When I grow in my thinking and my knowledge, I am able to do subtler vivek, but then I am not able to live up to that subtler vivek, then there is greater sorrow. We'll see some examples as we go along. So suppose between good and pleasant, I give a very simple example. Between good and pleasant, that is called shreyas and threyas vivek. So if I know that to eat salads and fruits and nuts and whatever, sprouts, is very good for the health, and to go on eating fried food and, you know, too much of sugar and milk and all that, and that is not good for the health. Now that is known, knowledge is there. If I live up to that, that much benefit also is there. Knowing that if I don't live up to that, that much more misery. If I may choose to ignore that with some justification, but it is there, conflict is created. And hence it is that there is a desperate need for discrimination in our life, which we don't realize sometimes. I have given only a few examples here, that avivek means lack of discrimination in food will definitely cause diseases. What to eat, when to eat, how much to eat, all that is not known clearly. Now it is so difficult to choose also what to eat. Because now season, there is nothing called season now. Earlier it was going by season, so you know that mango will be available 3 months. It is good in that time. Now one can put in deep freeze, and even in December they will give you amaras. June ka rakha hua. According to Geeta, I don't know what category it comes under. Because Geeta said 3 hours ke baad food has become tamasic. He says, I don't know how many crores like that is here. But that's the way they are. So we, that avivek, lack of discrimination, that will cause at any level. In speech, I don't know what to talk, what not to talk, whom to talk, how to talk with that person. Gone. I will create enough conflicts, and big wars have happened only because of speech. Both Ramayana and Mahabharata are an example of that. Right. Mantra and Kaikeyi, they could not control their speech. And this Draupadi could not control her speech. Gone. Big wars are fought. Avivek in speaking. Avivek in work. So we don't maintain that work-life balance, then enough stress is there. And the deepest is this, avivek in the identity. When I don't know who I am, then I seek happiness from things outside. Then all the 6 impurities will come, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madha, masarya, and then other 2, bhaya and shoka, fear and sorrow, 8. All because I did not give enough importance to discrimination. Knowledge is one thing to have. When we start analyzing, then discrimination arises, and then when we live by that, that knowledge, that vivek will become vairagya. So jnana will lead to vivek, vivek will lead to vairagya, vairagya will lead to atmajnana. It goes like that. So this chapter, 13th chapter, before we go into the subtlest form of vivek, which is to know who is the knower and what is the known, we have to prepare ourselves for it. Because when we say that I want to discriminate between self and the not self, if my intellect is not subtle, it cannot discriminate. How to make that gross intellect, which is right now stuck only in what to eat and what to do and where to go and whom to meet, stuck only in that much. Now and then it will do little more better vivek, okay, which career to choose, what type of hobby to have, that much. But it doesn't do subtle vivek, which makes it ready for the subtlest, to know the self. So, these are the different types of vivek. So, first category of vivek, which one has to start living by, is called dharma vivek. And I have to live by those, and these will prepare me for the higher type of vivek, which is brahma vivek, to know who I am and what I am not. So, if I go by this quickly, dharma and adharma means what is right and what is wrong. How to know what is right and wrong? In any circumstance, it may appear that right and wrong are relative, possibly, but to determine what is right, what is wrong, in this given circumstance, this is the right thing to do. There are certain criteria which are there, and one should go by those to understand and then apply what is right in that context. If one says there is nothing called right and wrong and I just feel like doing and I think this is the right thing to do, then one may or may not be doing justice to that. And basically one is not using vivek. In Vedanta it is the exact opposite of the way the world functions. In the world they say, don't think too much. In Vedanta we say, think properly. I don't know for what they preserve this buddhi and peace. Subtle vivek for what? Where is it going to be utilized? I don't know. If they are scared, if you utilize it, it will get over. Then anyway, by not utilizing it also, it is getting destroyed only. So buddhi has to get awakened. So to know what is right and wrong, it's very dicey to know what is right and wrong. But there are criteria on the basis of which you can clearly determine this is the right thing to do in this situation. Shreyas and prayas, good and pleasant. So this is one sign of self-mastery, shreyas and prayas. In every situation, if I am able to stick to shreyas, then that is my control on my own mind that I have. In terms of food, getting up, meeting people, work, whatever, browsing on computer, phone call. Early morning I get up and then there's a phone call which comes. It may sound very pleasant to just sit and relax and talk to that person, but I'm going to miss my walk. Then that is not. So there one has to share some prayers with it. So, shreyas and prayas, what is good and what is pleasant? Then comes sadhana and sadhya. Means and the goal. What is the means and what is the goal? Again, that simple clarity one must have. That is wealth the means or the goal? Means. Inside satsang, wealth is the means. Outside satsang, wealth is the goal of life. Here is a technically accepted correct answer. Wealth is the means. Artha is the means. Karma is the means. Good values, are they the means or the goal? How can they be both? How can the road be the destination? It can be only the means or the end. Values is a goal. But why is it not a goal?
Because
you can grow. You can create, you can reject. So why is it not
Because through them you are trying to reach God.
So they are a means to purify the mind. And they fluctuate. You can leave a value, you can not leave a value, you can compromise in the value. So they are a means. Dharma is a means. Dharma cannot be the goal of life. And that's what we have to know very clearly. Being good and doing good, etc. is a means in life. It cannot be the goal. Moksha, is it a means or goal? So to strive for moksha, all the others are the means to get to state of moksha. So we should know. If I say God, is he means or goal? What will you say? Pakka, God is a goal. Why is I? God is means or goal?
Goal.
Be careful, I mean. If God is the goal, don't go tomorrow morning and stand in front of Bhagavan and say, Bhagavan, bless me with 2 children, 10 cars, $50,000. Then Bhagavan will become what?
Means.
Then God is the goal. If God is the goal, then you can't ask for this. So you decide, what do you want? I say, no, for me God is both, you know. Means also, goal also. So God is an exception who falls into that category. He can be both means and goal. But that vivek one must have. Basic point is that what is the means and what is the goal. If I know very clearly that happiness is the goal, just imagine how much things change in our life. Petty little issues, they become so important because they are the goal for me. Approval of somebody is the goal. I put my entire life's energy to get that person to like me, approve, appreciate. For what? If they don't do it, then their problem. We leave it. Beyond that, what can we do? But so many times that whole life goes only in one relationship, two relationships, trying to get that person to like me. Okay, you don't like me, that is your problem. Bhagavan loves me and everybody else loves me. What? Move on. But mind does not understand that. Mind gets fixated on that. That means and goals. Certain percentage, my God, how much tension? Children go through, parents go through, and so much anxiety, depression, only because the fixation is on that certain percentage. My child must get into this. So means and goal. That is the sadhana and sadhya vivek. Then part and the whole. What is the part and what is the whole? So professional life is a part of my life or is the whole life? Generally it appears as the whole life. At one particular stage in life, that is only the life. Parents especially need that clarity. 10th standard is 1 year of life. It is not full life. My God, they make the children horses only in that 1 year. Nothing else they can see. What? 10th standard, don't look left, right. What? How much tension? And the strange thing is, child is not getting tensed now. Parent is getting more stressed out. Okay, why this fellow is not tensed out, tensed so much? Sometimes the other way also it's happening. There's no doubt. Some of the children get very psyched up, 10th standard. Very happy, nice, normal children, they are till 9th standard. And now what all things are happening is ridiculous. One wonders where it is going. Training for IIT started in 6th standard.
Yeah.
I said, what is this? Yeah, you find out. Somebody told me. Training for IIT entrance, coaching has started in 6th standard. I said, what madness, what competition is this? No vivek, no, clarity is not there. The life of that child is systematically gone. They won't have any other thing to do after that. Because so much pressure. And the saddest part there is, it is linked to the self-esteem. If you don't clear it, that means you are not good enough. That is a sign. If one takes it in one stride, that is okay. So this part and the whole, that my life has many parts. It is not one whole. One part may predominantly be there in one stage of life, but the rest I cannot ignore. And happiness and sorrow. Mind will go only where there is happiness. It will not go where it thinks there is sorrow. So if I want it to do certain things, I need to start finding happiness in it. If I don't like to go for jogging in the morning, I have to start finding happiness in that. So if I cannot start loving jogging straight away, find some other means of happiness in that. So go with somebody with whom you love to go. So they are rowing, so you also tag along. A lot of people who walk like that. Groups. So there is a motivation. Personally, you tell them to go alone, they may not go. But chalo, we go together. So they find happiness through that and then you go. It will not go in those places where it feels there is misery. It will only go where it has find, it finds happiness. And hence, if that vivek is done very clearly, that if I want to inculcate a new habit, I have to start finding my happiness in it by seeing the benefit that it gives. And slowly, slowly that condition will change. This much, these five types of vivek are called dharma vivek. If I do these five, then I am ready for the subtler vivek. These subtler vivek are, we have given five names, but actually it is only one. There is no difference. All these are different names. Atma and Atma means what, who I am truly and what I am not. Who I am truly is that which is sentient. It is not inert. The body, mind, intellect are inert. They appear to be sentient and functioning on their own, but they are not. Because when we see a person dying, dead, what is the difference? The life spark has gone away from it. So by itself, body did not have capacity to be alive. There was something else in living. So they all are one actually. Atma itself is that which is Chetan. Itself is the one who is the seer. Atma is the one which is Sat Chit Anand, and Atma is the one which is the Purush. So actually the subtle vivek is only one. To know the reality and to disassociate from that which is the unreal. But to get to that one subtle vivek, subtlest form of vivek, I have to do all the others and prepare the mind. And hence a seeker who has done this, now the question here that he is going to ask, Arjuna is asking, is of this drashta and drashya, seer and the seen, meaning the knower of the field and the field, prakriti and purush, the matter and the spirit, and then what is that which is the knowledge and what is that which is the goal of that knowledge, that comes under this 13th chapter now. So now, when the known is different from us, it's a very simple point here. If the known is different from me, then I have to know about it and I have to put effort and get it. Like anything, no? Suppose degree I want. Now that is, if I want MBA, let us say. Now that known, that knowledge, that is different from me, that degree is different from me. So I have to study all those subjects, I have to put that effort and then I have to get it. Suppose I want a car. Car is different from me. So then I have to know about which type of car, what is my requirement, how many people will sit in it, where will I use it, and I have to understand all that. Then go and buy. So where the knower and the known are two different things, the knower has to put the effort to gain knowledge about the known and then get that known. But when the known and the knower are same, then I have to do sadhana only to get the right understanding. No action is required to go out and do something. What is the example for that? When an actor who is acting forgets himself and thinks he is the role. Maybe Amitabh Bachchan thinks he is a
beggar. Now what does he have to do? Does he have to go work hard, collect money and then again become the multimillionaire that he is? Does he have to do knowledge and action both? Or does he just need the clarity that, I am not this beggar, I am already a multimillionaire? Only the knowledge is required. Why? Because the knower and the known are the same. They are not different. So in this context here, the self is the knower. And that is what is to be known, that who am I? But I don't know that. Not knowing that is what I think that happiness is out there, so I am running behind it and doing so much of action and still getting temporary satisfaction and then again in sorrow. So this discrimination between the knower and the known should be very, very clear. So now Bhagavan begins that in this 13th chapter. So when Arjuna is asking this question, that please tell me the difference between Kshetra and Kshetrajna. So he starts with this second one. Shri Bhagavan Vacha.
Idam Shariram Kaunteya. Idam Shariram Kaunteya.
Kshetra Mitya Vidhiyate. Etadyo vetti tam prahu.
Etadyo vetti tam prahu.
Kshetrajna iti tadvidaha.
Kshetrajna iti tadvidaha.
He says, idam shariram kamteya. This body, O son of Kunti. So the word kamteya also means one who is very sharp, who can discriminate. Kunta means sharp. Kaunteya means one who is sharp. So because this is discrimination chapter, it says Kaunteya. Kshetra mitya vidhiyate. This body is called as a Kshetra. So the body here, idam, this is a technical understanding. Idam in Vedanta means anything that can be pointed out as this. Aham means I. So whatever is I is called aham. Whatever this I can objectify as this, that is called as the idam. So he says, idam shariram. So this word sharira does not mean only body. The word sharira does not mean this gross body only. It means a body. So the physical body, sthul sharir, mind and intellect, sukshma sharir, and the cause of both these, karana sharir. All these three are called the field, kshetram. Field here means that which is seen, separate from the seer. So this law of the seer and seen are very, very important to know. So the seer and the seen are different. They cannot be one. This is the first discrimination. Right now, the seer and seen are one. When I say I, what do I mean in that I? I mean this body, mind, intellect. So I am not separating it as seer and seen. The BMI is the seer for me. Vedanta says, no, no, no. There is separate. The seer and the seen are two different things. At the physical level, are we not able to see the body? So the seer of the body is different from the body. There is a gross seer. Are we not able to see our emotions? Meaning feel. Anger was not there, now anger came and that person said like this, and so then my mind was very disturbed and then I got angry, I shouted at that person and now my anger is lesser and now it is subsided. So there is a seer of this emotion rising, building up, staying, expressing, falling. Though I may be carried away by it right now and I don't see a distance, I don't see the space between these two, the seer of this emotion and the emotion. But there are two. Why do we say there are two? Because if the seer is not there, we will not experience only the anger. There is no experiencer. If there is no experiencer, how can there be a experience? Because what is an experiencer? Experiencer contacting the experienced gives rise to an experience. So the thinker giving rise, contacting the object and the emotion that arises or the experience that arises. There is a thinker who is seeing it, experiencer who is seeing it separate. Hence the seer and the seen are different. First law. Second law, the seer and seen cannot be one at the same time. Meaning what? So, eye is the seer and this glass is the seen. Can the eye and the glass be one at the same time? Cannot be one. The mind is the seer, which sees through the eye. So the mind is the seer and the eye is the seen. Can these be together? No. Mind and the eye cannot be, otherwise seeing cannot happen. Mind backs the eye, then knowledge of what I see arises. Seer and the seen can never become two, or never be the same at the same time. They are separate. So in one case, in this example that I gave right now, in the first case, eye is the seer, glass is the seen. In the second case, mind is the seer, eye has become the seen. So same eye at one point is the seer and other point is the seen. But at the same time, can it be both the seer and the seen? It cannot become one. Why this is important to know? Because we mix up. Even in the heaviest of identification that we have, deepest of identification with somebody, with some emotion, with some object, we don't become that. There is one part in me which remains separate. That part is what I have to identify with to create that detachment. If I don't identify with that part, I feel I am getting carried away. That's why we say that emotions are overwhelming my thinking. Even when emotions are overwhelming my thinking, there is one part which is knowing that or not. That right now I am getting overwhelmed. It may be very tiny part at the moment. Major will be the overwhelming part. But there is still that part. So the seer and the seen can never become one at the same time. Seer cannot become the seen and vice versa. Can the eye become the glass? Thank God, it doesn't become. Can the mind become the eye? Not possible. And the vice versa also is not possible. Glass also cannot become the eye also cannot become the mind. So they will remain separate only. Seer and seen will remain separate. These things are very necessary to understand. They look like some technical law of, in Gyan Marg, these are six or seven laws in seer, drashta, drashya, vivek, this is seer and seen. But they have philosophically a lot of implications. That the seer is the one which is conscious. Always the seer will be conscious. Just imagine if that principle is understood, there is no problem in identifying consciousness. In science, there is a big problem. Science doesn't accept only consciousness. That's why quantum physics has evolved out of it now. And quantum physics very, very clearly will say that the observer affects the observed. Maybe tomorrow also I will show you one video, an experiment what they have done. And how a particle changes behavior when it knows that it is being observed. Very nice experiment in quantum physics. The particle is behaving in a particular way, but the moment it recognizes that there is someone watching, it changes the behavior. Which means what? The particle has intelligence, consciousness. Very nice experiment. Like that, there are lots of things in quantum physics. There is one whole group which will not accept it also.
Swamiji, there is the same thing when you touch water and say a mantra. They have done a test where they are seeing the particles of the water, the atoms. But they say the water is energized because of that.
That is a different point, because there you are influencing it with your energy and the chanting. Here one is saying that a particle has inherent intelligence that it knows that it is being watched, and it changes behavior. Very interesting experiment.
How does this apply to us?
It applies to us because in each of us there is consciousness, which we don't realize that there is a consciousness. We think that this body, mind, intellect is the ultimate. So if the body is dead, chalo, there is a mind and intellect that carries forward, goes to the next life. But how do these function? They function because of consciousness, and this consciousness is not something, you know, what you say, out of this world somewhere. It is that which is enlivening everything. So-called inert, so the consciousness is there even in this. That's what science is saying now. So traditional science will tell you that there is no consciousness. Everything is the matter. Quantum physics will say, no, there is nothing called matter separate from consciousness. This, the basis is consciousness now in quantum physics. That it appears as matter is a limitation of our own, one is the senses, and second is the behavior. So that way to understand that consciousness is all this is what Vedanta also is saying, that equipment may be different, but consciousness is the same in everything. The expression, like electricity, is the same. Now, just because this cannot give light, does not mean electricity is not there. This will give the air. Something else gives music. That's an expression, but that doesn't deny existence of electricity. Same way, the expression here may not be same as this body. This body is able to speak, this is not able to speak. That doesn't mean consciousness is not there in that. So that is the implication here, that if I know that consciousness is the seer, the ultimate seer is consciousness, and the seen is always inert. So from consciousness standpoint, everything else is the seen. This hierarchy you should know clearly in Vedanta. From the object standpoint, the senses are the seer, object is the seen. From the standpoint of the mind, mind is the seer, senses are the seen. Standpoint of intellect, intellect is the seer, mind is the seen. So emotions come and go. From standpoint of intellect, self is the seer, intellect is the seen. Now you may say that from some other standpoint, maybe self is also the seen. So that goes into infinity grace. Whichever factor you call that, that ultimate factor is consciousness or not. That is what this is. Seer is conscious. The seen is always not. Which means my nature is consciousness. Which means that change can happen in anything, but I don't change. I am that changeless absolute Brahman. All my sorrow and misery is only because I don't know that. Hence the law of seer and seen are very subtle discrimination, and these apply in the seat of meditation. Please remember, this is not for intellectualization. In the seat of meditation, when any experience happens, we have to know it is an experience and let it go. It may be a good experience, good thought, bad thought, even including darshan of Bhagavan, including blue light, yellow light, white light, including the feeling of universal love and oneness with all creatures. It comes and goes. It is seen. I, the seer, is completely different. That is the heights of Vairagya, where I don't attach myself to anything which is seen. Whatever is seen is rejected. Imagine what level of Vairagya that is. Anything that is experienced is not me. Gone. Rejected. That's why if you come to a Vedantin, you get rejected and negated. That is the hallmark of a Vedantin, rejection and negation. If you are expert in rejection and negation, you are a Vedantin. Meaning you negate not other people. This also, this being, body also you negate. This is not me. Emotion also you negate. Intellect also you negate. Experience that it goes through, negate. Fluctuation of self-esteem, negate. So Vedantin doesn't matter for him whether it is a good self-esteem, low self-esteem. Self-esteem only is a is negated from meditation standpoint. So the seer is consciousness and the seeing is always enough.
What do you mean meditation standpoint?
When you are sitting in meditation, then you are withdrawing from everything. In that state, you reject everything. Don't go home and say that, you know, you think nothing matters, food doesn't matter, life doesn't matter, work doesn't matter, nothing matters. That's the role you are playing, one has to play. But once you know, okay, this is the equipment playing this role, I am the sakshi, the seer. This is clarity here. The nature of the sakshi is consciousness. And if you say that, no, there is nothing called consciousness, I am a sakshi, complete confusion. Because you don't know what is the nature of sakshi. Now, enough philosophies out there which will tell you that. Don't worry, atma hai, nahi hai, consciousness, this, that, just be a sakshi. But who is that sakshi? How to know that sakshi? What, if I say sakshi, it's just a word, no? What does it mean? Does it mean one thought judging another thought? Then how can it be sakshi? So one has to be very clear that consciousness reflecting through the buddhi assumes the role of a sakshi as the seer identifies with the seen. So it has become one. So right now I am trying to stand apart from the seen and say that I am a sakshi, this is the seen, this object comes and goes. That if I keep doing in meditation, when there is nothing to see, the seer also reigns. Sakshi also goes. That is the highest state. Sakshi is not the highest state. Sakshi is the ultimate state of what you call it. Sadhana that one can do. Beyond that one cannot do sadhana. One has to let go there. When there is nothing to observe, I have negated everything, the negator also goes away. The nature of the negator is consciousness. That's what Vivek is. So this discrimination in the worldly, in my duties, it will help me to understand that this is a role that I am playing and I am the seer, the consciousness remains unaffected. So to maintain equanimity, this is very, very powerful. This understanding when I have, that no matter how much turmoil the mind may go through, how much excitement it may go through, how much happiness it may go through, nothing happens to me because that is still the seeing. I am the seer. But at which level I identify myself as a seer is important. Do I identify myself as a seer as a body or as a mind or as a intellect or as a witness? The deeper is the level of identification, greater will be my detachment and I remain unaffected. Hence this is that seer is never affected by the qualities and properties of the seen. How much one goes through, you know, as a seeker. Not that these are not important to control anger, fear, you know, overcome these negativities. But at some point in time, one has to know that these are a part of the scene. Of course, that capacity comes only when we control these, otherwise we are carried away by these. But how much we go through guilt, sorrow, agitation, because we go through this attachment to the scene. So if we know that the screen is never affected by whatever is being projected on it, at the end of the whole movie, the screen is the same white as it was before the movie. Just imagine our life like a movie. I was a white screen before, I am a white screen afterwards. My entire life which is there in between is only a movie. And it has not touched me. Karma also doesn't bind. From consciousness standpoint, karma doesn't bind. Which means what? Nothing happened. Whole Allah Bulla is for what? Something which has not happened. From consciousness standpoint, nothing happened. From vehicle standpoint, did anything happen? In dream, I went through this, I won lottery, I enjoyed, I had 10 children, I was so famous and suddenly somebody killed me and looted away my wealth and then I got up. What happened? And I wake up, I realize neither I got married, nobody killed me. I was the baker, I am still the baker. Then all tamasha happened. If that standpoint I keep while I am living here, keep some tamasha is going on in that, what role I need to play, that much I will play, baki it goes on. And I know deeply enough that nothing happens to consciousness and that is me. How free will be the mind? Then one can just play. So seer is never affected by the qualities of the scene. At whichever level, again these are such beautiful laws that you can apply this at the any level. Like the seer is not affected by what happens to this, the eye will never be affected by it. Whatever happens to the eyes, mind will not be affected by it. Whatever happens to the mind, my buddhi will not get affected by it. Whatever happens to the buddhi, sakshi doesn't get affected by it. So if I can take that step of being the sakshi, being the seer, and know that the seer will never be affected by the scene. The seer can see the scene, but the scene cannot see the seer. Very simple. Scene is changing, the seer is changeless. So the sakshi remains the changeless, ultimate seer. Even at other levels, the seer remains changeless. From the standpoint of this glass and the eye, if the glass goes through a change in the shape, eye doesn't go through change in shape. The scene goes through changes, not the seer. Hence, these laws of the seer and seen, if I understand very well, there is a great amount of clarity while living in the world, doing my actions, still remaining unaffected, and then I can sit quietly in contemplation and know very well that I don't have to go anywhere, I don't have to become anything, I don't have to achieve anything. All I have to do is drop my identification with whatever is seen. Whatever comes is to be negated. So if you ask me what has to be done in meditation, in one word one has to just say negation. Just negate, keep on negating. That's why in the Upanishads and in the science of Vedanta it is said neti neti. Not this, not this. You cannot know the reality by positive definition, impossible. But you cannot define the reality. You can only negate what it is not. What remains when the negator also goes, that it is. And that cannot be explained. We may give words, sat, chit, anand, truth, bliss, infinity, anything. Those are words. So tomorrow we will see this a little more. Then we go to the second part. Actually for today we are done. The first part, kshetra and kshetrajna, from individual standpoint is over, that the body, mind, intellect and causal body, these are the kshetra, field, and they change and they are inert. The changeless is the sakshi, which is the self. The same principle if you apply in the world outside, just like we have body, mind, intellect, in the world outside there are these eight aspects, which was said earlier, ashtadha prakriti. In this chapter it will be explained as 24 elements. So that much part about the seer and the seen relating to the world we will see tomorrow, and then come to the jnanam and jnayam. And third day will be purusha and prakriti. So that is the 13th chapter. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om.